Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming. And I'm looking for, there we go. The first thing I'm going to do, you've got some information about each of the authors here. We want to spend our time talking with them and talking with you. First thing I'm going to do is object to the title of this session. Nobody ever called The Great Gatsby bro-lit. So how did we end up with this idea of chick-lit? I mean, I might go along with it if you've got Zane Grey versus 50 Shades of Grey. Other than that, no. And the authors up here show how that versatility belies what it is that the whole subject of the panel is to be about. So I want them to engage. Obviously, this is something they've given thought to, about why it's called women's literature before we talk about women writing literature. What about it?
Oh, me? Okay, yeah. Great. So I was actually thinking about this when I saw the title of the... Oh, I'm Lauren Groff. Hello.
I'm so sorry.
Hi, I'm Lauren.
Karen Fowler.
I'm Geraldine Brooks.
There we go. Thank you for reminding us to introduce ourselves. I'm the author of Fates and Furies.
I'm the author of the Jane Austen Book Club, and we are all completely beside ourselves.
And I'm not even going to list them, but the last one is The Secret Chord.
There we go. So I was thinking about this because I had just gotten back from the Women's March on Washington, which was one of the most empowering, joyous things. Yes, and we need to do that again today. But one of the things that I actually got a place where I could actually hear the speakers, and there's one of the female senators who came up on the stage, one of the 20 out of 100, and she said, you know, when people invite me to speak about women's issues, I say, okay, and I start talking about economics, because economics are women's issues. So we can talk about anything, women in fiction. We can talk about technology, we can talk about war, we can talk about anything, because everything is women's fiction. That's what I think, but what do you think? Karen?
Well, I certainly don't agree with that. I was also at
you
the
don't
march
agree?
On... I do agree with that. Sorry. Sorry.
I was going to say, ooh, let's get into it. Good. Yes.
I don't disagree with that, is what I meant to say. And I was also at the Women's March on Marsh. I'm surprised I didn't see you there.
I know, right? About 1.2 million people there, yes.
But,
we want a leader, not a creepy tweeter.
But this is certainly a topic. I'm on several chat lists with many other women writers, and this is certainly something that comes up quite frequently and with great annoyance, that somehow... if a book written by a woman focuses on family in particular, then it's women's literature, unless it's by Jonathan Franzen, in which case it's...
Or John Updike.
Or Jeffrey Eugenides, yeah.
Yeah.
Or Stephen Fowler.
Right.
So it's complicated, and I will just start by sharing one experience that I've had. I've been on two juries for prizes, and both times the women on the jury outnumbered the men, and both times the prize went to a man. And what I think I saw happening is that we were all in agreement about which the good books by men were, and we were in wild disagreement about which the good books by women were. So it's not that everybody on the jury didn't love some books written by women, it's that we didn't agree. And so I think often the prizes and the attention goes to men because that's where the consensus is. And we all know what a great book by a white man looks like. We don't all know what a great book by a black woman looks like.
And so are those other books then compared? Does the white man's book become the yardstick for literature?
Well, there were certainly some criteria that initially looked aesthetic, but actually favored certain kinds of literature. So on the first jury, the male juror said that he wanted, that what he loved was really spare prose, and he did not want to give the prize to anything that did not strike him as beautiful, and this is what struck him as beautiful. And because it was an international award, you know, the first thing I noticed is we've eliminated every book from India. Mm. All of those are no longer in contention.
Tell us which award it was.
Yeah, just say it. No, just say it.
It was the Discover New Writers Award.
Right.
But yeah.
And Geraldine?
So I'm just looking at the audience here.
Yes.
There is a real thing. Why are so few people of the male persuasion at a panel on women's literature?
And thank you, men who are here.
Yes. You are the very best of men.
You are. Yes.
But I'm not embarrassed to say that I'm more interested in telling women's stories. As somebody who writes about the past, I like to find the lost voices, the people who didn't get to set down their exquisitely crafted pensées because they were up before dawn and working till after dark. Or they never got a chance to learn how to read and write. So a lot of my work is to do with delving back into the past to try and hear women's voices. And interestingly, when somebody didn't write journals, there are no journals by women in colonial America until the 1750s. So that's a whole 100 years of women's history where we don't have one journal, very few letters. Where can you find her? Well, you find her in court. She's dragged in there because she's accused of being a scold, one of my favorite crimes that women committed. And being a scold meant you were overheard criticizing a man in public. And I'm really glad that one's not still on the books because...
Everybody in the Women's March would now have that.
But, so, you know, verbatim testimony, that's where you can hear her voice. But, so I'm not apologizing for wanting to tell women's stories at all. And I think that's, and you know, my book March, whenever I ask an audience, a mixed audience, you know, who's read Little Women, all the women's hands shoot up and none of the men's. Hmm. And so what? I don't care.
You also find the voice of colonial women in captivity narratives, which I find really amazing. And if you haven't read Mary Rowlandson's recently, it's one of the most beautiful, actually, texts from America, I think. But every captivity narrative is sort of moderated through the voice of a man, the man who published her, or the men who came together and sort of built a narrative out of her really horrible ordeal. So it's really fascinating.
There's a line in Geraldine's new book that really sums this up. The narrator is talking to one of the wives of David, of King David in Israel. And she said, nobody ever writes that about a woman. It's always the man whose love is thought worthy of recording. Have you noticed that? In all the chronicles, they state it so. Write it down that I was the one who loved. Her observation was quite true. Indeed, in most of our important histories, it's rare enough for wives to be named, never mind the state of their affections noticed.
So, yeah, that comes out of a line that really jumped out at me in the text of Samuel, where it says, Michal loved David. And I just realized there's nowhere else in the Bible where a woman is the agent of the union, right? It's always the guy, and, you know, they don't get a name. Lot's wife, anybody? Yeah. Gladys? Noah's wife?
Salty
Frances?
Sally.
You know, so, but David's wives are very briefly sketched, but very strong individuals, and so that's one of the things that attracted me to that story.
When I knew I was going to do this panel, I went to Virginia Woolf's book, A Room of One's Own, and the line, you need somebody to shush the kids and fix the dinner if you're going to get the work done. And she wrote, you need the liberty to travel and to idle, to contemplate the future and the past of the world, to dream over books and loiter at street corners and let the line of thought dip deep into every stream. In short, you need the leisure that men get thanks to the work that women do, and to flip those roles. And it's only been recently that I think women have had the legal right, and with, you can argue even with birth control, have the physical power to make those decisions for themselves. The question is then, what can you do about the writing that women do to say this is half of our story, this is half of our human story, and not end up like children's toys, girls' toys, and boys' toys?
wait, okay. Go ahead, Karen.
You know, I think clearly two things that that at least in this country, women are the book buyers and the readers in overwhelming numbers. But secondly, that New York Publishing believes very strongly that women will read books by men and men will not read books by
Hollywood
women.
Hollywood does the same thing with movies, too. Women will go to men's movies, but men won't go to women's movies.
So if you want to get the largest possible audience, even though the largest possible audience is primarily women, you appeal to the men. It is the conventional wisdom. Now, when I wrote my second novel, my first novel had a male protagonist. And my second novel, I sort of based it loosely on, and I know I will mispronounce this because I always do, Gaudy Night. It's not Gaudy, is it? It's Gaudy, or anyway, the Dorothy Sayers mystery that takes place in a women's college. And, you know, it's all women and Peter Wimsey. And the way I did this in my book was to create a town after World War II where the men had gone off to war. And so the women are left. And when I turned it in, my editor said, there was just a long silence. You know how dreadful that long silence is when you've sent a manuscript in. And finally she called me and she said, well, I think you had a male following with your first book. I don't think they will follow you into this one because it's all women. And I said, well, you know, I don't see a way to rewrite it so that it's got man in it, and she went away for a while, and then about a week later, she sent me a letter with some things she thought needed to be fixed, but it seemed very enthusiastic, and so the next time I talked to her, I said, you know, you seem much happier with the book, and she said, yes, I am, and I said, you know, what about the problem that no men are going to read it, and she said, oh, well, I thought about that, and I decided, fuck them.
Can I answer this?
Yes, please, Lauren.
So, I've been dealing with this problem my entire career, and I think most women do, right?
Yes.
So for this past book, Fates and Furies, I decided to write the first part in the man's perspective in order to seduce the men into reading a book about a woman, because the second part is about a woman, right? And then it turns the story topsy-turvy.
Yes.
And then you realize
the whole book was
about
the woman.
The whole book is about the woman, right? So I actually intentionally did this in order to bring men in. The truth is, though, men would not read my book until President Obama said he liked it. And then suddenly men read it. It became this thing that men could read, which is...
They like a sticker, I found.
They like a sticker,
a prize, like buying a bottle of wine, you know.
You're right.
Oh, it's got six stickers on it, it must be all right.
It reflects well on them that they're reading this award-winning book, as the phrase goes.
Interesting.
I'm thinking of women who've had to hide their gender to sell. I mean, even if you look at one of the great, unquestionably great American novels, To Kill a Mockingbird. Harper Lee, you can go both ways on that name. You can think it was a guy. Mm-hmm. J.K. Rowling was told to use only her initials when she wrote the Harry Potter series, so it would appeal to guys. And one of the great mystery writers, P.D. James, did the very same thing. So we don't have to do that now, but there's a price to be paid for this. Does it? You talked a little bit, Karen, about, well, I'm not rewriting the story of a village full of women to make it about men. But even subconsciously, are you thinking about that, as you did, Lauren, when you said you were suckering the guys in the first part of the book? When you do write, and you don't want it to be just about women, or you don't want it to be just considered as a woman's book, is that even a subconscious thing you think that comes to the surface as you sit down to write?
It certainly does not come to the surface as I sit down to write. It sometimes comes to the surface when I see how my book is going to be marketed or the cover that is going to be put on my book. And, you know, my most vivid experience of this was the Jane Austen Book Club, which particularly when it came out in England, had a pinkish cover and... And I said, you know, I think you're trying to persuade people to read the book who are not actually going to like the book. But the cover sold really, really well, so they were they were impervious to that complaint. But I kept saying, you're trying to make it look like chick lit. And they kept saying that they absolutely were not. But it, I am so right, and they are. But as I said, it worked quite well for them, so.
Geraldine?
You know, I don't think about it at all. The only person that I'm writing for is myself initially. I write
so a woman.
Books that I like to read and hope that you will like them too. But I don't try and think, oh my God, am I going to hit a demographic or anything like that. I just find a story that really appeals to me and just go for it. But, you know, when you were talking about Room of One's Own, it reminds me of that fairly appalling British critic philosopher Cyril Connolly, who has the famous line about the baby carriage in the hall being the greatest enemy to the production of great art. And I love what the Irish writer Anne Enright said when she smacked him down. She said, the baby carriage in the hall isn't the enemy to great art, it's the enemy to great drinking. And I wouldn't have become a novelist if I hadn't had a kid. I was happily cruising as a foreign correspondent on planes all the time to desperately tragic places. And then suddenly, you know, I'm pregnant with my son, and I thought, I don't want to leave this baby to go off on a long open-ended assignment. What am I going to do? And it was because of the experience of having kids that connects you so much more deeply into what it means to be fully human. Yeah, I'd love to have a wine-fueled all-nighter sometimes where I just sit in my room and ignore the fact that the dinner has to be on the table and somebody has to find the soccer cleats, but life doesn't work like that. And I think it's good to be anchored into real life.
And you're, in this book, you have King David as the sun around which all the planets orbit, and your narrator, who is a man as well. But you have the women's voices come again and again.
I tried to find a woman narrator for that story, believe me, because I much prefer to write in a woman's voice, and I always try and write with a first-person narrator because I love the directness of that. But I couldn't find one woman who had enough scope to tell his whole story, so I went, oh, dear.
Women's worlds are larger than they were because of many changes, legal changes, social changes. But you think back to Jane Austen, matchmaking and dealing with families, that was work. That was their careers. That's what they had to do then. Mm-hmm. It was same as if you went to work in a bank in the city in London. This was the work that was put to you because of the sphere that you were allowed to occupy. And some people were good at their work in Jane Austen, as you saw, and some people were not. And so it fascinates me that when you do read literature by women of that period, it is just as serious and just as substantive as what the men were writing, but the sphere is different altogether. And so you, in particular, would know about that.
This is not directly an answer, but it's something that the first thing that came to my mind when you were talking about women's lives being larger now in some ways is that one of the things that I find, and Geraldine, maybe you'll speak to this as well, when I do historical research, is that I have a kind of vision that is the sort of conventional wisdom about what women were doing and what women could do, and yet when I go back and I actually find women, they're doing everything under the sun. It's
incredible. Yeah, I wanted to see if it was plausible for my first novel to have a woman making a big journey, and so I researched travels of 17th century women, and it was mind-blowing. You know, my favorite, I couldn't use it because it was too implausible, even though it was true, was a Quaker woman who went off to, she decided that it was her destiny to convert the Sultan of the Ottoman Empire, so she traveled alone and got an audience with the Sultan, which nobody did. Nobody ever saw the Sultan. And she ended up in South Carolina. You know,
And that was a woman of the 1650s. So, you know, these are amazing stories of what people
I think we've allowed ourselves to be persuaded that women led uninteresting lives. When
it's completely untrue. Yeah.
Lauren, you were nodding.
Oh, I agree. Yes. yes. Yeah. But I also think, I mean, there's we tend to devalue women's work just in general, right? I mean, we devalue what it takes to raise a child. We devalue the work that women have traditionally gone into, cooks until the men came in and became chefs, right?
Teaching.
Teaching. Oh my gosh, nursing. We devalue all of these things that are so necessary and so important. It's the same in literature. You know, if it's in the sort of the women's sphere, the domestic sphere, we just automatically, even people who are staunch feminists as I am, it's in our society that we tend to take out a lot of the energy and we don't see it as equal to something else.
Is that why you chose to tell the story of a marriage here in Faith and Fury?
Oh, there are many reasons why I chose to do it. Well, partially because I am married, but I don't necessarily believe in the institution of marriage. because the institution of marriage, I think, it just traditionally is misogynistic, right? I mean, it's based on sending young women off into other families in order to ally the families and to allow the control of land. And a lot of the things that I see in contemporary...
Even if the land is a condo.
Right. So, but in contemporary sort of ideas about what men and women can do are based on these latent ideas from marriage, right? The domestic sphere is a woman's sphere only, right, in particular. So I resisted very, very deeply, and I wanted to actually look at marriage, among many other things. And I thought I was writing two separate books that were going to be read interchangeably until about the very end.
And they became one?
And they became one.
You married your books.
Actually, my agent married my books, my male agent. he sat there, and I thought for sure, because I thought I was writing something that no one would ever publish. So we sat at this little tiny Greenwich Village organic, like vegan cafe, eating these terrible cakes all day long. And he finally pushed the two books together, and he goes, "Look, you've replicated a marriage within one single book." And I was like, all right. Then I had to go back and rewrite everything yet again in order to make it work as a single book.
But in your book, you have a wife who, along with others, really conspires to support a husband, his ego, to make him believe in himself,
right,
which is almost a classic. It's a standard idea that the man gets the credit and the woman does the work that allows him to take the credit.
Yeah. So what interested me about this was I had done a lot of research and I had read a lot of biographies of great male writers, particularly Stacey Schiff's absolutely amazing biography of Vera Nabokov, which everyone should read. It's so incredible. But, you know, Vera Nabokov in particular was this genius. I don't know how many languages she spoke. I mean, she was probably highly literary. She wrote a lot of his lectures that he gave. She was incredible. But she sort of subsumed herself within the mythos of the individualized genius who Nabokov was, and he could not have been without her. So I was really deeply interested in this idea and trying to look into the heart of someone who does that, right? To look into the persons who withdrew herself into the shadows on purpose, intentionally. Because in all of these biographies, the figure of the wife is always obscured in the light, the radiance of the figure, the solitary male genius at the center.
You brought up Harper Lee earlier too, and I was thinking in terms of A Room of One's Own and also a more recent send-up of that by Joanna Russ called How to Suppress Women's Writing. And one of the standard ways is she didn't really write it. Somebody else wrote it for her. So there's all this Truman Capote kind of energy around To Kill a Mockingbird, when so often what we find out is exactly the opposite. Right. She did write it.
She wrote a lot of
he
it.
He put his name on it. Mary Shelley also being a classic sort of who really wrote Frankenstein.
And Karen, your book deals with a family we could call it a mixed family. I don't know.
Yeah.
And I don't want to give I don't want to give away the secret, but it certainly does stretch the boundaries of a definition of family. Can you talk about that without maybe giving away your MacGuffin?
I think the cat's out of the bag, isn't it?
Is it?
Okay.
Is it?
Yeah.
Well, let
or
me,
some species.
Let me just see a show of hands, and please don't be embarrassed. How many of you have read my book? See, a lot of people haven't.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. You know, the book is the first... About a third of the way in the book, there's a revelation that you're not supposed to know ahead of time. Although, in fact, if you read the back cover of the book, you do know it ahead of time.
That's cheating.
But when I do go out and talk about it, I often think there's no point in trying to keep this a secret anymore, only to have somebody in the audience say to me, "Now, I hope you're not going to spoil the book for everybody by telling the secret." And then I just think, how sad. How sad it will be if the person who spoils my book for you is me. But yes, in many ways, I think all literature looks at the question of what it means to be human, and my book just does that in a more literal way, trying to see where exactly the boundary is.
So often we consider how one gender writes in the voice of the other, or the idea that a piece of praise that a male reviewer may think is great is like, she writes like a man.
Yeah.
No higher praise, she writes like a man. So how assess women writing men's voices, and certainly Geraldine, in this book you had to do that, and men writing in women's voices, and how that's changed, and what's essential to that.
Like I said, I find it much easier to hear the voice of women, even though you have to delve a little bit more to get the exact cadences and preoccupations, because, you know, my first experience of writing in a male voice was March, and because I wanted to look at the issue of what happens to idealists at war, the only way to do that in a Civil War context was through a male narrator. And of course I was, you know, as opposed to my previous novel where I had to scour to find anything from the period in the voice of a woman from that time and place, Bronson Alcott, who I based my character on, never shut up. You know, he had voluminous journals and extensive correspondence, and, you know, you could hear him. You had this, like, perfect source for the voice of a Victorian idealist there, so it was, in some ways, a lot easier.
You also have the perfect example of a man whose life is made of the mind is made possible by the work of all the women around him and his family.
Oh, well, I think we do. I think we look at him with a very harsh 21st century feminist lens, because for a man of his time, he did an inordinate amount of child-rearing. Whether you approve of how he did it or not, but he was certainly extraordinarily supportive of Louisa May's writing career and of all his daughters, you know, whatever their destiny, he was right there. And even when Louisa May wrote her wonderful send-up of him, his notes in his journal were really the proud dad, you know, she's caught me with bold strokes. I think we're a little harsh on Bronson. Yes, he did insist on 3 iron shirts a day, which was no small bit of business in those days.
Was it the Brontes whose brother was given credit for their work? Everyone thought, oh, he must have done it.
I think he was so weakly that nobody really gave it, right?
I think that the dynamic there, I think, was just that he was the one of whom much was expected.
Right.
So the daughters were, nobody anticipated that they would be able. And they did have to publish under male names when they first published. Mm-hmm. But no, I don't think... I think he was such a wreck.
He was a painter, not a very good one. Right? He was painting, but so the interesting thing about this question is that there is no parallel panel on men in fiction. right?
Yes.
So the truth is, even if we are, women are a greater part of publishing, and we are. I mean, there are more women in publishing, there are more women publishing books, there are more women buying books. Still, the standard is male, right? And I actually think that if whatever the standard is, it's harder to write from within that tradition. So I actually think that it's easier, for instance, for a woman to write in a male voice because we're writing against sort of what has always been known. I think it's probably easier for a writer of color to write in a white voice because the standard
because
is
that's the
white
prevailing
voice, right? And it's harder for a white male to write in the voice of, say, a black woman. It's just much harder, I think, because you have to question everything when you do that.
Well, I mean, the question's come up, and that is, should you even attempt it? Do you have the right, as a white man, to write in the voice of a black woman, et cetera, et cetera? What do you think of some of those reactions that have come out now, that you're not entitled to write as X because you are not X?
You can write in whatever you want to, but it the right is in publishing, right? In sort of, I think you have the right to do whatever work you need to do.
You can't have an apartheid of the imagination,
no.
Is what I...
Right.
And, you know, I always think of my wonderful neighbor on Martha's Vineyard, Bill Styron, got taken to the woodshed when he wrote in the voice of Nat Turner. And there was a book of essays. And now I'm going to have a brain freeze, but wonderful black writer came to his defense. And said something that's been my lodestar ever since I read it, which is, each of us, helplessly and forever, contains the other. Mm. Male in female, black in white, white in black, we are part of each other. And if you can't believe that there is only one story, which is the human story, then I think you're living in a very narrow, arid little room, and I would hate to live in a world where I'm only allowed to write about Australian women of the 1960s and 70s of Irish extraction. You know, boy, that would be a tough haul.
But there is, however, appropriation, which is different, I think. Mm-hmm. It's taking someone else's work in ideas and culture and calling it your own. And I think that's what people are angry about, not the apartheid of the imagination, which I think should not exist also, but about profiting off of someone else's.
So I had to confront this with Caleb's Crossing quite a bit, because Caleb's Crossing is the story of the first Native American graduate of Harvard. And it blew my mind when I learned that he graduated in 1665. And I thought, how did that happen? How did somebody at the first moment of contact with colonial invaders, essentially, raised in his own language and culture, master Latin and Greek, and go off and sit down and learn with the sons of the Puritan colonial elite. And I just wanted to, and of course he didn't leave a journal again telling us what it was like to be him, what that experience was. And so the only way to engage with it is imaginatively, and I wouldn't try and tell it in his voice, but I wanted to engage with the fact that that happened. Mm-hmm. And so we had a lot of discussion with the Wampanoag Indians of Martha's Vineyard, where I live, about what was appropriate and what wasn't. Mm-hmm. And some still think I shouldn't have done it because it's not my story to tell. Mm-hmm. And others are really glad that I did it because they think his story should be more widely known.
If you had not done it, there's no guarantee anybody would have.
Well, somebody, and me doing it doesn't stop anyone else from doing it. And also, you know, a wonderful writer, Powers, from the Standing Rock Sioux, had already written a short story about him. But she's not Wampanoag, so does a Sioux have the right to tell a Wampanoag story? So you can posit many different ways, but I still feel that, you know, and I've always felt that what unites us is greater than what divides us, and that no effort of empathy, no matter how imperfect, should ever be despised.
What works influenced you growing up, not only to be a writer, but influenced the way you regard the world? What did you read?
I always answer this question with The Once and Future King. which I read when I was about 14 and which I reread fairly frequently, and which I think, you know, is now so much a part of my DNA that every once in a while when I reread it, I will come across a line that I have used in a book, thinking I made it up. And there it is. The important and powerful influence it had on me as a writer was just to make me impervious when I started doing writer's workshops to anybody who said I had broken some sort of rule, that, you know, there were all these rules that I did not know existed that I was breaking, and they would say, well, you know, you can't do this, you can't do that, and I would think, T.H. White does it, so I know I can. So,
how old were you when you first read it?
About 14.
Lauren?
Oh, so I was pathologically shy, so I read everything when I was little. But I think the ones that had the biggest impact on me were this little book of Greek mythology, Greek myths, that I love Greek myths. I love fairy tales because it's almost like the skeletal idea of what a story is, and you sort of flesh it out yourself. And I love that so much. I mean, it was just great training. And then when I was 14, I read Middlemarch, and it blew my mind. And that's the book I go back to every year, because I just want to sit in George Eliot's wisdom and grace for the span of the book.
Yeah. I think the one that made me think it might even be possible to write fiction was a book I read when I was about 14, too, which is The Persian Boy by Mary Renault. And that's a book about Persian eunuch who was a historic, actually lived, who was a servant to Alexander. And there's something about the way she takes you into this completely different, very distant cosmology, and everything about the belief system and the setting is different, but the human heart is the same. And you can, she just, you know, shines a light into the past in such a humanistic way. So I think that one really influenced me. And I've probably stolen lines from that unknowingly. I'll have
but,
to go
but
back
But you
and
make
check.
Me think that there are authors like Octavia Butler who write science fiction who can create the whole world, a whole universe, and therefore change the rules about how men and women get along. And that's a very powerful tool. And maybe that's an emerging frontier for fiction written by women that has not been fully explored yet, and that there are many possibilities there.
Well, I sometimes write science fiction, and I certainly read a great deal of it. And when I began reading it, it was the 1970s, and second wave feminism was in full blossom. And I truly had the impression that science fiction was a feminist literature where all the women were working.
Except in Star Trek, the women still wear short skirts and the guys get the pants.
Yes, but Joanna Russ also says about Star Trek that she thinks it created a whole generation of female science fiction writers, partly because we had been told that you had to have a great deal of deep, actual scientific knowledge, which was a barrier to a great many of us until we watched Star Trek and realized all you had to say was dilithium crystals and the problem is solved.
Well, Ursula Le Guin proved that you didn't need all that science to be able to write that sort of alternative future fiction as well.
Well, she had that deep anthropological
from her
knowledge.
Father. Yes.
Well, I mean, Charlotte Perkins Gilman in 1917 wrote Her Land, which is amazing. It's all about just like this world of or land of women where they parthenogenically create more women. Mm. It's incredible. It's a utopian text. I mean, women have been pushing the bounds. Mary Shelley, right?
Mary
I mean,
Shelley.
Everyone's been pushing the bounds since we can grip a pen, I think.
So I really loved Lord of the Rings, and when I heard they were going to make movies about it, I thought, oh my God, I have to read this to my kid so he can imagine his own hobbits before he sees somebody else's. And he was a bit, you know, he was about five, and we sat on the porch one summer, and I sort of force-marched him through Lord of the Rings. And he couldn't accept that there were no women doing anything in it. So he decided that Mary, the hobbit Mary, was a girl. So I had to change the pronouns all the way through.
That's a very hopeful sign for a new reading audience, isn't it? It just seems implausible. And so from your point of view now, do any of the new technologies serve you and your art, and to reach audiences who might not have otherwise, who are not looking at your name but your work when they say, I decide I want to read that? Podcasts, internet, anything?
I think the new technologies stop me from getting a lot of work done. I watch too many dog videos.
I had a discussion many years ago when the internet was just becoming a real feature in my life with the noted futurologist Bruce Sterling, and he said, we are entering a great age of information. And I said, we are entering a great age of misinformation. Mm-hmm. And I think both of us turned out to be right. Mm-hmm. I think at the moment it's tipping my way. but yes, I've always felt the new technologies are just, I'm just sort of balanced on a knife edge over whether they improve my life or have destroyed my life. It's one of the two. I don't know which.
Yeah, so, I started writing long before I published, but I've been publishing only in a world where all these new technologies have existed. Oh, yes. So I don't have any basis to say. Yeah.
All right, let's have some questions. If you want to stand up and shout it out, I'll repeat it anyway so we can get it on the record. Let's start in the back. Can you stand up and shout it out? A little louder, please. Sure. The question is the larger or smaller readership of books like biographies, detective fiction, short fiction, how it may expand and contract according to that particular part of writing that genre.
I'm not the full bottle on publishing statistics, but my husband, Tony Horwitz, writes nonfiction. And I think, he has an overwhelmingly male readership. And mine tends to be overwhelmingly female. So whenever we do a joint event, that's about the only time we get a 50-50 audience.
But you've written nonfiction as well.
Yeah. My first book was Nine Parts of Desire, but it was a book about Muslim women.
Yeah.
So I would get some males in the audience, but usually they were the bearded guys who'd come to pick a fight with me.
But does nonfiction, in fact, belong for the most part, or has it belonged to men? Because it's stuff about wars, and it's stuff about governance, and that sort of thing.
This is very anecdotal, but I, on many occasions now, meet people who tell me, that they love books and that they read a lot, but they only read nonfiction. Mm-hmm. And these people are more often men than women. And this is something I've noticed too in the many years now that I've been publishing, that when I started, the New York Times Book Review was almost all fiction and, a couple of nonfiction books. And that also seems to have flipped in many ways. So I'm not able to answer really the question about the audience, except that the audience for nonfiction seems to be larger in many ways. And this brings me to something which is a current pet peeve of mine, and I'm not the sort to suffer in silence, so I'm sharing it all with you. This this obsession, even when I've written a book of fiction or when someone else has written a book of fiction and I hear them interviewed, with finding out which parts are true. Mm. That, you know, the interview or the review is all, you know, so which parts actually happened to you, or if in a historical, you know, which parts did you find in your research, which I just feel gives very short shrift to the imagination.
Yes, the old based on a true story, the Hollywood version of that.
Yeah, exactly.
There was another question up here. Can you stand up, please?
Yes. I wonder if you would each speak briefly to your process and how perhaps your process has changed from early in your career, kids and families and work, versus, you know, at a point where you've obviously all achieved quite a level.
So how your writing process has changed over time, influenced by what else is out there, by your own lives and the demands on your lives?
So I got lucky. I married a feminist. And he's extraordinary. And I wrote up a contract long before we had children, which said on it that if we were to have children, I can do this sort of thing. I can fly out to California. And I can wake up at 5 in the morning, and he takes the kids to school, and I don't have to see them at all. until the end of the day. So we carved out a space. I carved out a space with his collusion, in which I get the Virginia Woolf closed door thing. And I've had that since the beginning, since I graduated from my MFA, because what he got in return is that I have to live in Florida. so awful. So you know, it's a give and take. I get up at 5, I go to work, I work as hard as I can until the kids come from school, and that's it.
I always want to answer this question by asking if you'd like to know what my process has been up until today, or if you'd like to know what it's going to be like starting tomorrow. But this brings us back to the new technologies, and we're running out of time. I want to give Geraldine, so I'll just do this very quickly to say that my tragically frequent process is to get up in the morning, to take a long walk, to answer my email, to check the political websites that I am obsessed with, to then think, I bet there's more email now, to go back and look at my email. You know, 20 minutes has passed, probably someone in my government has done something really dreadful. Back to my political websites, and I have no idea how I ever get a book written, because it's just that circle.
Oh, Geraldine is nodding, of course.
I'm afraid, yes, that rings a lot of bells. But I always think, I have a friend who's a sculptor. Her name is Sarah Z, and she described her process so perfectly. She said, my process is mess, 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 art. And I think that is really consoling, because there's not one single day when you can't make a mess. So you just have to get up and you have to put something down. And it might be the worst thing ever, but at least you've done something. Because if you don't make that mess and have something to work with, then you'll never get to the art piece of it. And that's why I don't believe in writer's block, because you can always make a mess. So.
As a British photographer once said, better a mess on deadline than a Botticelli 10 minutes late. Not so much the novelist's work, but certainly a lot of creative people. Won't you please thank our great panel today?